Read the book, the whole book, not as your sponsor sees it, part of the book. Not the Reader's Digest expurgated version of the book, the whole book. My wife and I abandoned ourselves with enthusiasm to the idea of helping other alcoholics to a solution of their problems. And that's the truth. Lois threw her lot in with Bill right away. From all accounts, she said, "Yes, Bill, I will help you." And she did. She backed him up in all of this. And it was a long, hard road because there was no such thing as instant success. And never after that did they have any significant amount of money. Lois kept on working at the department store for quite a while after Bill got sober. Bill was able to make a little money here and there in the stock market. But basically, they were living on pretty much of a shoestring. But Lois lived up to her commitment, and she stuck with Bill. And she stuck with him all the way through. And after he died in early part of 1970, right here in Miami at the Miami Heart Institute, Lois continued the work. And so this commitment, when he says, "My wife and I abandon ourselves with enthusiasm to the idea of helping other alcoholics to a solution to their problems," he means that literally. It was both he and Lois who did that. It was fortunate, for my old business associates remained skeptical for a year and a half, during which I found a little work. What he means by it was fortunate that she agreed, because otherwise, without her salary, they wouldn't have survived financially. I was not too well at the time and was plagued by waves of self-pity and resentment. We don't hear a whole lot about that, and Bill, in his other writings, seldom alludes to how he felt in that first 6 months period. We have a lot of information about his ups and downs, his depressions, and his suicidal impulses, and his LSD use and other stuff later on. That's pretty well documented. But exactly what was going on with him right after he got sober, this really, as far as I know, in all the literature, this is the only place that he alludes to it. That he was filled with waves of self-pity and resentment. Now, I don't know what resentment he's talking about. I guess maybe it's not important, except that we got to notice that Bill was far from being well at this point. And you could almost say, in many respects, he was walking around with untreated alcoholism. Self-pity and resentment are two of the most brutal defects of character, ones that will just tear us down. He goes on to say, "This sometimes nearly drove me back to drink, but I soon found that when all other measures failed, work with another alcoholic would save the day." Let's turn to page 89, please. Right top of page 89. "Practical experience shows that nothing will so much ensure immunity from drinking as intensive work with other alcoholics. It works when other activities fail." So you can see that all the way through, the big book is entirely consistent. The same message is repeated to us many times. It's a good thing, too, because alcoholics really, really need repetition. You've got to ask yourself, how much of it do you remember from meeting to meeting? And sometimes it means that we have to have a lot of repetition before a lot of this stuff really sinks in. "Sometimes I have gone to my old hospital in despair, hoping that Dr. Silkworth could give him some magic bullet that would solve his problem. But when he came back to town's hospital, he found himself over there in the hopeless ward," in which, by the way, Dr. Silkworth had established in the hospital. They had a kind of a triage going on there, and there were the chronic alcoholics Dr. Silkworth knew he could not help. He one time reported that he had had over 20,000 alcoholics come through his hospital, and very, very few had ever recovered. And he kept on trying in spite of all that. Well, when Bill went over there, he would go and talk to these guys. And he tells us what happened. On talking to a man there, I would be amazingly lifted up and set on my feet. So he was learning. See, he first got the inkling of this from Abby when Abby came to work with him. But now Bill is finding out for sure that the answer to his own problems was to carry the message to others. And that's the basis, that's the foundation of Alcoholics Anonymous. See, without that, probably most of us wouldn't have the gumption to get out there and carry the message. But carry the message we must, because if we do not do so, we don't keep the grace that we have been given. It was a design for living that works in rough going. That we're not just dealing here with some kind of a bunch of ragtag theories that were all cobbled together by a bunch of old guys sitting around smoking cigars and pipes and basements. Something which came together as an inspired document, and it provides us with a design for living, a spiritual way of life. And this is what it is. This is what we live with, and this is what provides us with the recovery from the disease of alcoholism. Design for living that works in rough going. Now, rough going is something, of course, which many of us experience as we go through sobriety. There's all kinds of stuff out there that can go haywire and screw in our lives, and other people don't necessarily cooperate with us. And sometimes there's some nasty stuff going on, but yet this design for living works throughout all of that rough going. Going on page 15, we commence to make many fast friends, and fellowship has grown up among us, of which it is a wonderful thing to feel a part. The joy of living we really have, even under pressure and difficulty. I've seen hundreds of families set their feet in the path that really goes somewhere. I've seen the most impossible domestic situations righted, feuds and bitterness of all sorts wiped out. Hundreds of families set their feet in the path that really goes somewhere, have seen the most impossible domestic situations righted, feuds and bitterness of all sorts wiped out. I have seen men come out of asylums and resume a vital place in the lives of their families and communities. Business and professional men have regained their standing. There's scarcely any form of trouble and misery which has not been overcome among us. In one western city and its environs, there are 1,000 of us and our families. We meet frequently so that newcomers may find the fellowship they seek. At these informal gatherings, one may often see from 50 to 200 persons. We are growing in numbers and power. And all of those numbers were inflated. And when Bill originally wrote it, he used the real numbers. Notice, though, that we're looking at something here which is very real and very important. And that's back on page 15, five lines up from the bottom. But scarcely any form of trouble and misery which has not been overcome among us. And that's literally so. There are several places in the big book it talks about the fact that we come from every possible environment. Some of us have come from the lowest possible places. Some of us have come from some of the high places, society-wise. Some of us have come in wearing whatever little meager wardrobe we had, and others have come in chauffeured by their chauffeur and attended by their maid in their Rolls-Royce limousine. But when it all boils down, it doesn't matter, because each and every one of us is a drunk. And for each and every one of us, there is a solution, and that solution is found here in the big book. And so it does not matter what our station in life was. It does not matter how far down we had gone or how meager our experience with alcohol might have been. The question always is this, and it's stated very well in the seventh chapter. It says this: if he is to find God, The desire must come from within. And for those who have that desire and are willing to put in the effort, the program and the steps always work. And so it does not matter from whence we came. The remedy is the same, and it may take some of us a little longer than others. Some of us may have quite a bit further to go physically and mentally than others. It's also true that we are people who would not ordinarily mix under any circumstances. If we were out there in the prior lifetimes that we were leading, those of us who were frequenting low bars and low places and living on the street wouldn't want to have anything to do with those snobs, those highfalutin Gucci types over there. Just the contrary, the opposite would be equally true. And yet, I know all of you have seen people come in that door who are down and out and raggedy and maybe kind of smelly and maybe stumbling around a little bit, and yet there are always people who go up to them and offer them help, offer them a hand, offer them coffee. That's the way we are. And those of us, by the way, who don't do that ought to be ashamed of ourselves. I can't imagine how anybody who is afflicted with a disease of alcoholism could ever feel superior to another person who was likewise an alcoholic. I suppose sometimes we do. Going on page 16, an alcoholic in his cups is an unlovely creature. Our struggles with them are variously strenuous, comic, and tragic. One poor chap committed suicide in my home. Here's the rule now. He could not or would not see our way of life. Let's take a look on page 30. First sentence. Most of us have been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. Now look at page 58. Have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path? Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. That's what this is saying here. He could not or would not see our way of life. So back on page 16 again now. I don't mind this bouncing around, but I think it's important for us to see how these things all tie together. Second paragraph, there is, however, a vast amount of fun about it all. I suppose some would be shocked at our seeming worldliness and levity, but just underneath there is deadly earnestness. There's another rule now, guys, and this is so important. Faith has to work 24 hours a day in and through us, or we perish. Now, there's going to be a number of different places in the big book where this question of faith is emphasized in much the same way. But I don't know of any other place where it's put so bluntly that faith must work 24 hours a day in and through us or we perish. And faith without works is dead. Notice the word work is used in this sentence very advisedly, because what it's really saying here is that we're taking our faith and we are trusting God, and we are taking the faith that we have acquired and we are sharing it with others. And we have 24 hours a day in which to do this. And if any of you have done extensive 12-step work, you know that it just goes with the territory, the 4 o'clock call, the 5 o'clock call, the midnight call. The call during the middle of watching the favorite television program. It doesn't matter. Sometimes we get called at work and we may have to make excuses to go help. But we're going to do that because faith must work within us and through us. Now, the through us part is very interesting too, because it ties in directly with the third step prayer, doesn't it? In the third step prayer, we ask God to take away our difficulties, that victory over them may bear witness to those we would help of His power, His love, and His way of life, which means, of course, that we're being an example of God's love, His power, and His way of life working in and through us so that we can be the example to those we wish to help. And it is through that example that we are able to accomplish our most important work. We're far more effective in working with new people when they see in our actions that we are living this program that we're talking about. Then they're going to want what we have and be willing to go to any length to get it. We must do this, it says, or we perish. And I suggest to you that if you haven't taken this seriously, you might consider doing so. And when you look around you and you see that the people in the average meeting today and a year from now, only half will be there. And you have to ask yourself, how come is that? Thought this stuff really supposed to work. It does work. But we can be given all the grace in the world, and if we're not putting it to work, if we're not putting our faith to work, we don't keep it. Going on page 16, most of us feel we need look no further for utopia. We have it right here and now. Each day, my friend's simple talk in our kitchen multiplies itself in a widening circle of peace on earth and goodwill to men. And by the way, if you this first paragraph, I don't want this. Please don't let this don't let it throw you off, because when Bill originally wrote the manuscript, he didn't say thousands; he said hundreds. But you see, there were some eager beavers among that crew. There were 25 or 26 of them who were the ones who were the so-called editorial board. And they didn't think that that was startling enough or persuasive enough, so they changed what Bill wrote from hundreds to thousands. And so if it doesn't quite compute that we are more than 100 men and women who have recovered, and now they're talking about thousands, don't let it throw you. Anyway, here's what it says. We of Alcoholics Anonymous know thousands of men and women who were once just as hopeless as Bill. Now that word hopeless, we got to be careful of that word, because it's defined for us back there in the four to the first edition with the qualifier, seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. Because obviously, if in fact it were hopeless, what the heck would we all be doing here? So it is the appearance of hopelessness. And of course, that's really the kicker. That's what gets people in here, that they truly feel that their situation is hopeless. We're once just as hopeless as Bill. Nearly all have recovered. They have solved the drink problem. Naughty, naughty, naughty. Who solved the drink problem? It wasn't them. But then it's a little bit early in this book to be throwing God out there and saying, you know, they, with the help of God, as they understood him, solved the drink problem. So what they mean, I suppose, is that through their efforts, they were able to find God, to surrender to God, and through his grace, they recovered. We are average Americans. All sections of the country and many of its occupations are represented, as well as many political, economic, social, and religious backgrounds. We are people who normally would not mix. You know, there's some who really like to take that little sentence and make hay with that. You know, it's kind of like we're people who wouldn't ordinarily mix, and they kind of look around, you know. Then you say, who, me? You wouldn't mix with me? It's like these, you know, do you ever get a kick out of these people get up here and say, I love all of you. I don't necessarily like all of you, but I love all of you. And at first they used to say, I wonder why he doesn't like me, you know. We're so paranoid. We are people who normally would not mix. By the way, not all paranoids are crazy, because there are people chasing them, you know. But there exists among us a fellowship, a friendliness, and an understanding which is indescribably wonderful. We are like the passengers of a great liner the moment after rescue from shipwreck, when camaraderie, joyousness, and democracy pervade the vessel from steerage to captain's table. Unlike the feelings of the ship's passengers, however, our joy in escape from disaster does not subside as we go our individual ways. The feeling of having shared in a common peril is one element in the powerful cement which binds us. But that in itself would never have held us together as we are now joined. And here comes the tremendous fact. If you, this is AA trivia. If you're looking for the tremendous fact in the big book, here it is. The tremendous fact for every one of us is that we have discovered a common solution. Now that's very instructive, isn't it? You see, today, New Age AAers are running around telling us, oh, well, there's no such thing as any kind of a program here, really. And remember that more will be revealed to you. And we get to learn from our friends, the psychiatrists and the psychologists and everybody else out there who's got a master's degree in something or other. And so we get to make up all our own stuff. We don't have to pay any attention to what the big book says anymore. Because there is no common solution. That's what they're telling us. The big book says just the opposite. That we have discovered a common solution. And what did they do, guys? They wrote it down. That's what this book is. This book is a revelation to us of the common solution which these people found. And they wrote it down and they said, to show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this volume. And that's why they wrote it. So that they could show us what they did. And they're saying to us, we truly believe that if you do what we did, you too will recover. Over and over again, it tells us, follow directions. Pick up the simple kit of spiritual tools. Over and over, we hear the same thing. And yet we keep hearing this stuff that would lead us down the garden paths and have us make up all our own things about how it works. It'll work better this way because some psychologist says so. If you were to pick up some of the 12-step programs that are out there, like some of the churches have 12-step programs, and the church stuff is great. The spiritual, the scriptural stuff is terrific. But look at the steps. They have the biggest idea how these steps are supposed to work. They're all scrunched and screwed around to sort of kind of like fit in with some sort of a preconceived idea about how they ought to fit. And they don't work. They do not work. So we have a way out on which we can absolutely agree. And that's what this book is, their agreement. And upon which we can join in brotherly and harmonious action. This is the great news this book carries for those who suffer from alcoholism. Okay, now then, we're going back. This is going to reprise for us the doctor's opinion. An illness of this sort, and we've come to believe it an illness, involves those about us in a way no other human sickness can. If a person has cancer, all are sorry for him, and no one is angry or hurt. But not so with the alcoholic illness. For with it there goes annihilation of all things worthwhile in life. It engulfs all whose lives touch the sufferers. It brings misunderstanding, fierce resentment, financial insecurity, disgusted friends and employers, warped lives of blameless children, sad wives and parents. Anyone can increase the list. Now this is a very, very important paragraph for somebody who's new. Somewhere in that list they're going to find themselves, aren't they? If they're even being the least bit honest about themselves by this time. And you know what? This is sad to say, but today, When somebody comes up to me who's drunk and slobbering around, I feel sorry for them. I know they're sick. Sometimes I just wish they'd go away. Because they're disgusting. Now I'll admit this to you. Now I know what I'm supposed to do and 99% of the time I'll do it. But there's a lot of times when I don't want to. And I've been doing this for 38 years. And I'm still not used to it. So you can imagine what's going on out there with people who have no idea what's wrong with us. I mean, the kind of responses and reactions and the disgust that we generate in others, it's no wonder that we're pariahs. It's no wonder that they, in the old days, they hid us away. They locked us up. They put us in insane asylums, or the family would build a bedroom in the attic and lock the door, whatever it took, get grandpa away from the kids, you know, a disgusting old man, because we didn't know. And so when we read this, we can clearly understand the kind of impact that our disease and the way we have functioned with our disease has had upon those who've been around us. Somebody once said, I don't know if it's true or not, but somebody once said that the average alcoholic, you and me, has seriously affected the lives of at least 7 other people. Just think of that. Increasing the impact of this disease 8-fold. And I don't think that that's very far from the truth. It's a scourge. It's an absolute scourge. And you know, it's been around here, been around with human beings practically forever. I think we talked about this before. They found that the Peking man in the caves outside of Peking, now Tientsin, or whatever they call it now, China, that they'd been fermenting berries 225,000 years ago. And you just know there were a bunch of drunks in those caves. And we haven't come any further than that, except that God, in His wisdom and in His mercy, 67 years ago, decided to step in and give us a solution that we never had before. There was no solution. And when we walk in these doors and we're feeling sorry for ourselves, if we only knew just how blessed we are to be here, if we only knew what a miracle was being worked in our lives to give us this opportunity for a whole new life, that when I was born in 1928, there was no such thing. You and I were dead ducks. Going on, we hope this volume will inform and comfort those who are or who may be affected. There are many. Highly competent psychiatrists who have dealt with us have found it sometimes impossible to persuade an alcoholic to discuss his situation without reserve. Oh boy, however true that is. Strangely enough, wives, parents, intimate friends usually find us even more unapproachable than do the psychiatrist and the doctor. The ex-problem drinker, that's you and me, who has found this solution, who is properly armed with facts about himself. Now please notice that there's nothing here about this is somebody who has a PhD in alcoholism, who can draw graphs and charts and that thing where you go down like this, you go back up like that, or is it the other way around? I don't know. All that stuff. Not somebody who is going to give us great insight into ourselves, because self-knowledge doesn't keep us sober. Someone who is armed with facts about themselves. And to do that, how do we get that? Because we have worked the steps. We have taken inventory. We have admitted to another person what's going on with us. And we have found out what our present reality is, and we found out what happened as we were coming to this point. And now when we go talk to somebody who is a fellow sufferer, we know what to tell them. And we know, they know that we know what we're talking about. And until such an understanding is reached, little or nothing can be accomplished. That the man who is making the approach has had the same difficulty, that he obviously knows what he's talking about, that his whole deportment shouts at the new prospect that he is a man with a real answer, that he has no attitude of holier than thou, nothing whatever except the sincere desire to be helpful, that there are no fees to pay, no axes to grind, no people to please, no lectures to be endured, These are the conditions we have found most effective. After such an approach, many take up their beds and walk again. None of us makes a sole vocation this work, nor do we think its effectiveness would be increased if we did. We feel that elimination of our drinking is but a beginning. Aha! Oh yes. Oh yes. The big book never once says don't drink. The elimination of our drinking is but a beginning, and take that word beginning literally, because that's exactly what it means. From here on out, we have stopped drinking. From here on out, the program of Alcoholics Anonymous begins. It begins right there. A much more important demonstration of our principles lies before us in our respective homes, occupations, and affairs. Again, now look, the book's again referring to the same concept as in the third step prayer, that we be examples. All of us spend much of our spare time in the sort of effort which we're going to describe. A few are fortunate enough to be so situated they can give nearly all their time to the work. And there are a few folks like that. Generally speaking, those folks will most often have to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, as Shakespeare wrote. Going on, if we keep on the way we're going, there's little doubt that much good will result, but the surface of the problem would hardly be scratched. Those of us who live in large cities are overcome by the reflection of those of that close by hundreds are dropping into oblivion every day. Many could recover if they had the opportunity we have enjoyed. How then shall we present that which has been so freely given us? We have concluded to publish an anonymous volume setting forth the problem as we see it. We shall bring to the task our combined experience and knowledge. This should suggest a useful program for anyone concerned with a drinking problem. Big Book says, and Bill said in his story, if an alcoholic fails and refuses to enlarge and perfect his spiritual life through work and self-sacrifice for others, he can't survive those certain low spots ahead, he'll drink again. Of necessity, there will have to be discussions of matters medical, psychiatric, social, and religious. We are aware that these matters are, from their very nature, controversial. Nothing would please us so much as to write a book which would contain no basis for contention or argument. We shall do our utmost to achieve that ideal. Most of us sense that real tolerance of other people's shortcomings and viewpoints and a respect for their opinions are attitudes which make us more useful to others. Now, of course, they're talking here, Big Book's talking here about people who are immersed in medical or psychiatric, social or religious considerations, and with those folks we don't argue. Our very lives as ex-problem drinkers depend upon our constant thought of others and how we may help meet their needs. You may already have asked yourself why it is that all of us became so very ill from drinking. Doubtless you're curious to discover how and why, in the face of expert opinion to the contrary, we have recovered from a hopeless condition of mind and body. And that expert opinion to the contrary is the opinion of the medical and psychiatric professions, which at the time this book was written were saying unequivocally, there is nothing we can do. These people are doomed. And there is no hope for them. And yet, in the face of that expert opinion, we have recovered. Then it goes on to say, if you are an alcoholic who wants to get over it, you may already be asking, what do I have to do? It is the purpose of this book to answer such questions, notice this word, specifically. We shall tell you what we have done. That's the clue, isn't it? What we're reading here, the solution they're giving us is the solution they followed. Good God, we got to pay attention to that. These are people who have recovered, and they're saying, please, if you'll do what we did, we know that you too shall recover. Before going into a detailed discussion, it may be well to summarize some points as we see them. How many times people have said to us, I can take it or leave it alone. Why can't he? Why don't you drink like a gentleman or quit? That fellow can't handle his liquor. Hey, why don't you try beer and wine? Lay off the hard stuff, son. His willpower must be weak. He could stop if he wanted to. Oh, you even hear that around here now. Some poor devil goes out and slips, and a half dozen people say, well, he didn't have to do that. He wanted to drink. He could stop if he wanted to. She's such a sweet girl. I should think he'd stop for her sake. Remember what Dr. Silkworth said about frothy emotional appeal seldom suffices? The message which will interest these alcoholic people must have depth and weight. The doctor told him that if he ever drank again, it would kill him. But there he is, all lit up again. What are we going to do with him? Lock him up. Take Grandpa and hide him up in the attic. Watch him, because if he escapes, he'll run over to the liquor store and be drunk again. Lock up the liquor cabinet. Grandma's trying. She got that look in her eye. Oh, man. What they don't know about us, huh? Now, these are commonplace observations on drinkers, which we hear all the time. Back of them is a world of ignorance and misunderstanding. We see that these expressions refer to people whose reactions are very different from ours. Now then, this is pretty interesting stuff right here. And we want to think this through a little bit because it applies directly to our fellowship. See if you recognize this. Moderate drinkers have little trouble in giving up liquor entirely if they have a good reason for it. They can take it or leave it alone. Well, gee, I just had a little too much to drink at that party and I got a DUI and the judge said I had to go to AA. But I don't need to read the book. I don't need to work those steps. Boy, it sure is nice here. I get all kinds of hugs from beautiful women. And everybody is so kind and nice to me and they give me all kinds of love. I've never had this before in my life. I'm just a little nerdy guy, and boy, here I'm something, and I think I'll stick around for a while. Of course, I don't have to read the book, or I don't have to work the steps. But I'm going to wipe down the tables, and I'm going to make the coffee. And not only that, but I'm going to tell everybody that's how I stay sober. I'm going to tell them that's service. Oh, okay. Now let's take a look at the next category here. Then we have a certain type of hard drinker. He may have the habit badly enough to gradually impair him physically and mentally. It may cause him to die a few years before his time. However, if a sufficiently strong reason, ill health, falling in love, change of environment, or a warning of a doctor becomes operative, this man can also stop or moderate, although he may find it difficult and troublesome and may even need medical attention. What about the real alcoholic? He may start off as a moderate drinker, he may or may not become a continuous hard drinker, but at some stage of his drinking career, he begins to lose all control of his liquor consumption once he starts to drink. Here is the fellow who has been puzzling you, especially in his lack of control. He does absurd, incredible, tragic things while drinking. He's a real Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. He is seldom mildly intoxicated. He is always more or less insanely drunk. His disposition while drinking resembles his normal nature but little. He may be one of the finest fellows in the world, yet let him drink for a day and he frequently becomes disgustingly and even dangerously antisocial. He has a positive genius for getting tight at exactly the wrong moment, particularly when some important decision must be made or engagement kept. He is often perfectly sensible and well-balanced concerning everything except liquor, but in that respect, he is incredibly dishonest and selfish. He often possesses special abilities, skills, and aptitudes, but has a promising career ahead of him. He uses gifts to build up a bright outlook for his family and himself, and then pulls the structure down on his head by a senseless series of sprees. He is a fellow who goes to bed so intoxicated he ought to sleep the clock around. Yet early next day morning he searches madly for the bottle he misplaced the night before. If he can afford it, he may have liquor concealed all over his house to be certain no one gets his entire supply away from him or throw it down the drain waste pipe. As matters grow worse, he begins to use a combination of high-powered sedatives and liquor to quiet his nerves so he can go to work. Then comes the day when he simply cannot make it and gets drunk all over again. Perhaps he goes to a doctor who gives him morphine or some sedative with which to taper off. Then he begins to appear at hospitals and sanitariums. This is by no means a comprehensive picture of the true alcoholic, as our behavior patterns vary, but this description could identify him roughly. Now, this particular paragraph, by the way, is very important for the new person. You can see why. And when we tell a newcomer to read the book, this is one of those things which really stands out. Now, what we're looking at here as we go through Bill's story and chapter 2 and part of chapter 3 is we're looking at the first step material. So we can see here that this is clearly first step material. And this shows us a sort of a thumbnail sketch of the progression. Now here's the question. Why does he behave like this? If hundreds of experiences have shown him that one drink means another debacle with all its attendant suffering and humiliation, why is it he takes that one drink? Why can't he stay on the water wagon? What has become of the common sense and willpower he still sometimes displays with respect to other matters? Perhaps there never will be a full answer to these questions. Opinions vary considerably as to why the alcoholic reacts differently from normal people. We're not sure why. Once a certain point is reached, little can be done for him. We cannot answer the riddle. We know that while the alcoholic keeps away from drink, as he may do for months or years, he reacts much like other men. We are equally positive that once he takes alcohol, whatever, into his system, something happens, both in the bodily and mental sense, which makes it virtually impossible for him to stop. The experience of any alcoholic will abundantly confirm this. These observations would be academic and pointless if our friend never took the first drink, thereby setting the terrible cycle in motion. Therefore, the main problem of the alcoholic centers in his mind rather than his body. You see how logical that is? We can't help, and there is no cure, there is no remedy for whatever it is in our bodies that causes us to be allergic to alcohol. The only thing we can do something about is whether we take that first drink or not. And that's what we're powerless over, and that's why we need God's help. If you ask him why he started on that last bender, the chances are he will offer you any one of 100 alibis. Sometimes these excuses have a certain plausibility, but none of them really make sense in the light of the havoc an alcoholic's drinking bout creates. These excuses sound like the philosophy of a man who, having a headache, beats himself on the head with a hammer so that he can't feel the ache. If you draw this fallacious reasoning to the attention of an alcoholic, he'll laugh it off or become irritated and refuse to talk. Now, once in a while, he may tell the truth. And the truth, strange to say, is usually that he has no more idea why he took that first drink than you have. Some drinkers have excuses of which they're satisfied part of the time, but in their hearts they really do not know why they do it. Once this malady has a real hold, they are a baffled lot. There is the obsession that somehow, someday, they will beat the game, but they often suspect that they are down for the count. Down for the count means over and out, buddy. Sayonara. And that may be what has to happen, right? May have to have reached that point of utter desperation, that point of total hopelessness, before being willing to walk through that door and ask for help. Let's take a look on page 30 just to remind ourselves. First paragraph, most of us have been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. No person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it is not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterized by countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. The idea that somehow, someday, he will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. The persistence of the illusion is astonishing. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death. And I think that word many should be most, not just many. Most pursue it into the gates of insanity or death. And that's what, through God's grace, we've been saved from, if we wish to have it. The question is, do we wish to have it? We all have to answer the same question for ourselves. Is my spirit, my soul worth it? Is it worth the effort? Or am I willing that my spirit be consigned to the scrap heap of life? And we make that choice. And if we decide that we as a spirit, as a human being, are worth saving, then we go about the business of taking care of what we need to do to see that that happens. Because we got all the tools we need to do that. Going on page 23, how true this is, few realize. In a vague way, their families and friends sense that these drinkers are abnormal. But everybody hopefully awaits the day when the sufferer will rouse himself from his lethargy and assert his power of will. Remember back in Bill's story? When he was talking about what Abby had said to him? He said, there was no more power in him than there was in me. And that was none at all. And that's when he did his first step, remember? Down at the bottom of page 23, the tragic truth is that if a man be a real alcoholic, the happy day may not arrive. He has lost control. Top of page 24, at a certain point in the drinking of every alcoholic, he passes into a state where the most powerful desire to stop drinking is of absolutely no avail. This tragic situation has already arrived in practically every case long before it is suspected. The fact is that most alcoholics, for reasons yet obscure, have lost the power of choice in drink. Our so-called willpower becomes practically non-existent. We are unable at certain times to bring into our consciousness with sufficient force, listen to this, the memory of the suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. This doesn't say we don't, it says we're unable. What is the point of saying to somebody, you got to keep it green, you got to remember your last drunk, and you say to them, I can't. I'm unable to do that. The suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. We are without defense against the first drink, and it is that first drink which sets us off. This is the truth. And this is the dilemma. And this is the problem. And this is what must be solved. And it is not going to be solved by human solutions. That we know. If human solutions worked, there'd be no reason for AA. We could close this whole 4 or 5 million of us down and go home. Just begin to use the human solutions. The almost certain consequences that follow taking even a glass of beer do not crowd into the mind to deter us. If these thoughts occur, they are hazy and readily supplanted with the old threadbare idea that this time we shall handle ourselves like other people. The obsession comes back, doesn't it? There is a complete failure. What part of complete don't we understand? Complete failure of the kind of defense that keeps one from putting his hand on a hot stove. The alcoholic may say to himself in the most casual way, it won't burn me this time, so here's how. Or perhaps he doesn't think at all. Strange mental blank spot. How often have some of us begun to drink in this nonchalant way, and after the third or fourth, pounded on the bar and said to ourselves, for God's sake, how did I ever get started again? Only to have that thought supplanted by, well, I'll stop with the sixth drink, or what's the use anyhow. When this sort of thinking is fully established in an individual with alcoholic tendencies, he has probably placed himself beyond human aid. And unless locked up, may die or go permanently insane. These stark and ugly facts have been confirmed by legions of alcoholics throughout history. But for the grace of God, there would have been thousands more convincing demonstrations. So many want to stop but cannot. Now, blessed are we. In italics, there is a solution. Almost none of us like the self-searching, the leveling of our pride, the confession of shortcomings which the process requires for its successful consummation. One of the scariest things the groups ever did was to start buying these things and hanging them on the wall. Think about it. When a newcomer comes in and sits down there and they're staring at this stuff they're going to have to do, wow, how am I going to do that? How am I going to write this inventory? How am I going to turn my life and will entirely over to God? How am I going to sit down with somebody and tell them about this stuff that I've been running from, doing geographics over, hiding out from, changing my name, whatever it took, not to have to face up to this stuff. And I'm going to have to admit it. And then all those people out there I've harmed, I'm going to have to go out there and make amends to them? No, thank you. It's a frightening prospect. I'm only kidding, of course. I think it's wonderful to have the steps up there. But because that fear is going to come sooner or later anyway, isn't it? And all of us have experienced it. What is this stuff? Holy cow, you people are nuts. We're talking about not drinking, and you're talking about going out and confessing all my problems. You're talking about becoming a religious nut, and all I want to do is not drink. What is all this? Well, we did learn, didn't we? But we saw that it really worked in others, and we had come to believe in the hopelessness and futility of life as we'd been living it. Ah, that's the key, isn't it? Of God's power, His love, and His way of life working in and through us. In other words, God, let me be an example to others of what's happening with me by my actions and very little by my words. And of course that prayer is granted. It's answered. In the 12th step we know that we have the answer to that third step prayer. And so now we see that part of the solution requires that the newcomer come to believe that this is working in us, and then that to see and to believe in the hopeless and futility of the life that he or she's been living. In other words, to reach that bottom. the state of seemingly hopeless state of mind and body, where there's no further place to go, that place of terror, bewilderment, frustration, and despair, that place of utter hopelessness. Not everybody who comes in the door has reached that, quite obviously. But many have, and those who have will find that it is much easier to believe what we say, that there is no way that you're going to be able to conquer this yourself. You need a power greater than yourself to stand between you and the booze. When, therefore, we were approached by those in whom the problem had been solved, there was nothing left for us but to pick up the simple kit of spiritual tools laid at our feet. We have found much of heaven, and we have been rocketed into a fourth dimension of existence of which we had not even dreamed. Well, you can put your own interpretation on fourth dimension. Sounds a bit esoteric to me. I think Bill was just using this as a simile. I doubt very much if he was talking about parallel universes or anything, or being in communication with spirit guides. I don't know for sure what he meant, but it is a place of elation. Some people like to refer to it as a pink cloud, but I believe the pink cloud was invented by people who don't like to see other people happy. And so I ignore the pink cloud thing, because I know people have been on a pink cloud since they got here and they never got off of it. Because they do the work. Because they feel the presence of God. Because they spend their days in a God buzz, not in a self buzz. No, not all the time, but most of the time. You remember what Abraham Lincoln said? Yeah, he said, "I reckon a man's about as happy as he wants to be." That goes for ladies too, I assure you. The great fact is just this and nothing less, that we have had deep and effective spiritual experiences which have revolutionized our whole attitude toward life, toward our fellows, and toward God's universe. So that's the solution, isn't it? Having had spiritual experiences. If you've read the original manuscript that Bill wrote, you will find that the term spiritual experience was used in the 12th step. In other words, having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps. And when the editorial board got hold of it, they changed that to spiritual awakening. And the term spiritual awakening appears nowhere else in the Big Book, just in that one place in the 12th step. But we know that the original intent, the inspired intent, when Bill wrote it, was the same as we were talking about here. Spiritual experiences, which translates into spiritual awakening, which means then that the solution is to have a spiritual awakening in concert with the 12th step, which we are required to work the steps in order to achieve. Yes, sir.
Bill, can I ask you a question? This spiritual awakening, how can we recognize it?
Okay, that's a great question. Spiritual awakening is nowhere defined in the Big Book, and yet we have all the clues we need. We go, for example, to page 84. It tells us that we will have entered the world of the Spirit. We go to page 85, where it tells us that we will have been restored to sanity and that the problem of alcohol has been removed. It does not exist for us. Again, on page 85, we're told that we have commenced to sense the flow of God's Spirit into us, just as we learned back in the second chapter, or fourth chapter, was going to happen. We also learn on page 85 that we have become God conscious, and furthermore that we have developed this vital sixth sense which allows us to be in connection with our God. Our whole attitude and outlook upon life changes. We have a whole new way of thinking. We have established a high degree of humility. We feel a great deal of gratitude. We have learned to be loving and tolerant of our fellows. We have all the tools we need to solve every problem as it comes up in our lives. We have a loving God with whom we have a close connection. We are able to meditate and be inspired, be intuitively inspired, not at all times, but most of the time. We've learned that we can trust our instincts. We know that the problem of alcohol has been removed and it will permanently stay away so long as we stay spiritually fit. We've climbed into God's pocket. We know we are securely lodged there. That sounds to me like a fourth dimension of existence, just as an allegory, a simile, something you can call anything you want. But we also call that a spiritual awakening, and as a result of that spiritual awakening, we are then empowered to carry this message to others. And the only requirement being that we stay close to God and perform His work well, and that's up to us. That's something we have to do on a daily basis. And so when we read this thing about spiritual experiences, let's read spiritual awakening. And spiritual awakening being all those things that we just discussed. Thank you very much for the question, by the way. That helped me clarify all of this. I believe, and I can't prove it, but I think you will agree upon careful consideration that the spiritual awakening is a very cogent way of saying this is the solution. Work the steps, achieve a spiritual awakening, and you will have realized the solution. You will have been given the solution. And then it goes on to say that the central fact of our lives today is the absolute certainty that our Creator has entered into our hearts and lives in a way which is indeed miraculous. Entered into our hearts and lives. In the fourth chapter it says that we will find God deep down within ourselves, that only there can He be found. In other words, that we are spirit, God is spirit, we are of God, He is of us. And I believe that this is telling us the same thing. He has commenced to accomplish those things for us which we could never do by ourselves. Our whole life changes. Our whole life changes. If you are as seriously alcoholic as we were, we believe there is no middle of the road solution. The easier, softer way does not work. We were in a position where life was becoming impossible. And if we had passed into the region from which there is no return through human aid, and that, by the way, is part of the definition of the chronic alcoholic, there is no return through human aid. We had but two alternatives, two choices. One was to go on to the bitter end, blotting out the consciousness of our intolerable situation as best we could, and the other to accept spiritual help. This we did because we honestly wanted to and were willing to make the effort. A certain American businessman, Roland Hazard, of course, had ability, good sense, and high character. Wow, that's a whole bunch of us, right? Okay. For years he had floundered from one sanitarium to another. He had consulted the best known American psychiatrist. Then he had gone to Europe, placing himself in the care of a celebrated physician, the psychiatrist Dr. Jung, who prescribed for him. Though experience had made him skeptical, he finished his treatment with unusual confidence. His physical and mental condition were unusually good. Above all, he believed he'd acquired such a profound knowledge of the inner workings of his mind and its hidden springs that relapse was unthinkable. Nevertheless, he was drunk in a short time. More baffling still, he could give himself no satisfactory explanation for his call. So he returned to this doctor, whom he admired, and asked him point blank why he could not recover. He wished above all things to regain self-control. Self-control. You see, he was assuming when he left Europe that he had established self-control. That was the same problem, again, that we find with both Jim and Fred when we get to their stories in Chapter 3. They thought that they could reestablish their control over themselves. And we have found, haven't we, that there is no such thing. Powerlessness means precisely the opposite. We have no control. He seemed quite rational and well-balanced with respect to other problems, yet he had no control whatever over alcohol. Why was this? He begged the doctor to tell him the whole truth, and he got it. In the doctor's judgment, he was utterly hopeless. He could never regain his position in society, and he would have to place himself under lock and key or hire a bodyguard if he expected to live long. That was the great physician's opinion. But this man still lives and is a free man. He does not need a bodyguard, nor is he confined. He can go anywhere on this earth where other free men may go without disaster, provided he remains willing to maintain a certain simple attitude. A lot of times Bill would say to people when he saw that they were really intent upon recovery, that they were really following a spiritual path, he'd say to them, with that attitude, you cannot fail. And he wrote that in much of his writing. It was one of his favorite clauses. With that attitude, you cannot fail. Some of our alcoholic readers may think they can do without spiritual help. Let us tell you the rest of the conversation our friend had with his doctor. The doctor said, "You have the mind of a chronic alcoholic. I've never seen one single case recover where that state of mind existed to the extent that it does in you." Our friend felt as though the gates of hell had closed on him with a clang. He said to the doctor, "Is there no exception?" "Yes," replied the doctor, "there is. Exceptions to cases such as yours has been occurring since early times. Here and there, once in a while, alcoholics have had what are called vital spiritual experiences." Notice the parallel, vital spiritual experiences. The parallel to the previous page, 25. That the solution is to have vital spiritual experiences. "To me," Dr. Young said, "these occurrences are phenomena," or the root word phenomenal, not to be believed. "They appear to be in the nature of a huge emotional displacements and arrangements. Ideas, emotions, and attitudes, which were once the guiding forces of the lives of these men, are suddenly cast aside, and a completely new set of conceptions and motives begins to dominate them." What's the promise? Our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. We were reborn. Remember? "In fact, I've been trying to produce some such emotional rearrangement within you. With many individuals, the methods which I employed are successful, but I have never been successful with an alcoholic of your description." Upon hearing this, our friend was somewhat relieved, for he reflected that, after all, he was a good church member. This hope, however, was destroyed by the doctors telling him that while his religious convictions were very good, in his case they did not spell the necessary vital spiritual experience. Here was the terrible dilemma in which our friend found himself when he had the extraordinary experience, which, as we have already told you, made him a free man. We, in our turn, sought the same escape with all the desperation of drowning men. What Bill is saying here is that when he and the other early members of Alcoholics Anonymous began their process of recovery, they looked to Roland H. and some of the others in the Oxford group for guidance to, in order to emulate them. If you want what we have and are willing to go to any lengths to get it, then do what we did. And that's what they followed. And then they have taught us to do the same thing. What seemed at first a flimsy reed has proved to be the loving and powerful hand of God. A new life has been given us, or if you prefer, a design for living that really works. The distinguished American psychologist William James, in his book Varieties of Religious Experience, indicates a multitude of ways in which men have discovered God. We have no desire to convince anyone that there is only one way by which faith can be acquired. If what we have learned and felt and seen means anything at all, it means that all of us, whatever our race, creed, or color, are the children of a living Creator with whom we may form a relationship upon simple and understandable terms as soon as we are willing and honest enough to try. There's the whole crux of the thing. A loving God with whom you and I can form a relationship upon simple and understandable terms as soon as we are willing and honest enough to try. And that's all that is required of us, that we be willing to try. When we get into the fourth chapter, we're going to find four times it tells us the same thing, that the only requirement to get started is a willingness to believe, to take some simple steps in the direction of that belief. It is not necessary when we get here to have any full-blown belief in a higher power. It is necessary that we be willing to believe there just might be a power out there and work toward that. Those having religious affiliations will find there is nothing disturbing to their beliefs or ceremonies. There is no friction among us over such matters. And so we have to be very careful always to remember that the religious life is their own. Our religious life, whatever it may be, is our own and is never imposed in one way or another, in any way at all, on our sponsees. We may not, no matter how evangelical we may feel, we may not take a sponsee and attempt in any way to convert them to our religious beliefs. When we have a newcomer, we have them read the book, the whole book, not as your sponsor sees it, part of the book. Not the Reader's Digest expurgated version of the book, the whole book. Why? Page 29. Each individual in the personal story is described in his own language and from his own point of view the way he established his relationship with God. These give a fair cross-section of our membership and a clear-cut idea of what has actually happened in their lives. We hope no one will consider these self-revealing accounts in bad taste. Our hope is that many alcoholic men and women desperately in need will see these pages, and we believe that it is only by fully disclosing ourselves and our problems that they will be persuaded to say, "Yes, I am one of them too. I must have this thing." You see what it's doing? This is critical first step material to overcome and to break down the walls of denial and to bring hope and to allow the new person to identify themselves with one or more of the stories in the back of the book. They have to read the book. And so when we start somebody out, we give them the book and ask them to read it.